This week on Eagan AM.
A one-on-one discussion with the superintendent about the future of Eagan High School.
30 years of scaring people and still going strong.
And a haunting wildcat report.
Live from Studio 1A, this is Eagan AM.
I'm Ron Burgundy.
And I'm Veronica Corningstone.
Robotics team is meeting tomorrow after school from 5 to 7:30.
And next Tuesday, there's a speech team informational meeting from 2:30 to 4:30 in Lecture Room C. I'm sure by now you've heard about the upcoming levy vote next Tuesday.
I may or may not know what a levy is.
It's a good thing we have Kaylin Fernandez live in the studio with the superintendent of District 196 to shed some more light on the upcoming vote.
On behalf of our entire student body, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to Ms. Jane Barron. She's the superintendent of our school district. Thank you for coming in on this rainy day.
Thank you.
Okay, so before we get started, I actually would like to share a story. When I was in eighth grade, you emailed me back after I emailed you about a debate project, and it was really cool, and I'm really excited to be able to interview right now, actually.
Oh, thank you so much. And I do need to do a shout out to Mr. Snowbeck's political science class, because I was just there last week, and there also was a student who was working on her debate for universal healthcare, and I hope she got that finished. She needed a few other facts.
Okay. So could you tell us what the current budget situation is for ISD 196?
I will. Thanks for asking. You know, we're looking at going into school year 14-15, which is next year, and 15-16, a $30 million budget deficit. $10 million for 14-15 and $20 for 15-16. I do want to give a little bit of a context to our budget.
Okay, yeah.
We have about a third of $1 billion in our budget expenditures.
So how did we get here? Like, what happened to get us in this mess?
Yeah, really good question. We are a public school district, and so that means that the state provides 75% of our funds.
Yeah.
Federal government, about 6%, not very much, mostly for special ed and food service, and then 19% comes from our property tax. So that gives you the overall picture. So in the last few years, most of you have noticed it's been a really rough economy. And when that happens, then there aren't the revenues going to the state, and then the state does not have the dollars to fund education at a level that keeps up with inflation. In fact, over the last decade, the district has received 1.5%. And so as you look at that, the increases are less than inflationary, as I mentioned, but expenditures keep going up at a higher rate, you start to get that gap. And right now that gap is about $30 million in the next couple of years.
So for the people who don't really know what a levy is, could you explain what this is going to do, how it's going to affect us specifically?
Okay, first of all, a levy is when you go out to your local taxpayers and you ask them to vote on a certain dollar amount, that the dollars will go to the school district. So when I talk about the different funding sources, and I mentioned that the local piece was 19%, that's what we're talking about, a portion of that. So as we go out to our voters, they're going to vote on a $10 million levy. What that means for the individual taxpayer, who we use the average value home, $225,000, it would mean a $184 increase. But because of new legislation now called equalization, the overall cost will go from $184 to actually $56 for the year.
And will this be enough to completely fix our situation that we're in right now?
You know, it'll really help, but we went out to our voters through a survey, and we asked them, what amount would you be willing to give towards the school district? And so the amount that we started at was $16 million, and they said that was too much. And so then we went down to $10 million, so we will not have to cut for 14-15, but we'll have to maybe cut some 15-16, but that's another year where the state funds us, so it depends on what the state does.
Okay, so for the people who don't really want to think about this, what's going to happen to not only Eagan High School, but the 27,000 other students and teachers who are affected if the levy does not get passed?
Well, yeah, and I'd also add that this really affects the whole community in 196. We have 150,000 people that live within this community. And so people, when they're going to vote, whether they have kids or not in the school district, want to know what this means. So we are looking at class size increase on top of what we've already done, because that's where we put our dollars. We put them into the classroom, so when we have to cut at that level, we need to go to classroom. We've already increased walking distance, so we're not going to go more into that transportation, but we're going to have to take some gifted and talented time away, some basic skills, which is small group instruction for kids to help them with math and reading. We also are looking at Lego League going away at the elementary, as well as Destination Imagination. I don't know if any if you've done that or not. Fifth grade band, which 75% of our fifth graders are involved in. And you think of the high school level, 9B sports will go away, which 340 kids now participate in that, and developmental psych will no longer be there.
That sounds absolutely frightening.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for coming in. For all of you who can vote, remember the vote is this Tuesday, November 5th. Please exercise your right to vote. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Kaylin and Superintendent Behrens.
And to all you seniors 18 and over, get out there and vote so you can get one of those cool stickers.
2 weeks ago, Tackle Cancer shifted into high gear.
High Schools Against Cancer sold ribbons and bandanas to help raise money.
And we ended up raising over $1,500.
And the pit looked hot, sporting a nice array of pink.
Thank you to all who participated, pitched in, and pinked out.
I love lamp.
What?
Nothing. If you didn't know, Halloween is tonight.
And if you aren't planning on hitting up some parties like me,
or staying at home with your dog Baxter practicing the flute like me, don't act like you're not impressed.
Then get together with some of your friends and rent a scary movie. According to the IMDb, here are the top 5 scariest movies of all time.
Coming in at number 5 is The Haunting in Connecticut.
The Thing comes in at number 4.
Number 3 is Orphan.
Number 2 is The Grudge. And coming in at number 1 is Nightmare on Elm Street.
Great Odin's Raven. Those seem scary.
A word of caution. 3 of those movies have an R rating. Do you know what I find scary?
Brick with a trident.
No. Small children.
We have Kayla Stuve, who went out to discover how Pinewood Elementary School kids are spending their Halloween.
What's your favorite kind of candy?
Sour Patch Kids.
Skittles. Snickers.
Milky Way.
What are you going to be for Halloween this year?
Space alien.
A ninja.
I'm going as a demon.
A morph.
A ghostbuster.
What does that look like?
It has an air jetpack and a ghost on it with red X's on it.
A Jedi and a dragon.
I'm going to be Cinderella.
Hey, what's your favorite part about Halloween?
Getting candy.
Candy.
Eating candy.
Probably the candy.
Getting candy.
Looking at the decorations and getting candy.
Thank you, Kayla. I remember when I was a kid. I was a pretty big deal. People knew me. U.S. shoppers are expected to spend more than $7.6 billion on Halloween this year. Candy, costumes, and house decorations continue to make this a popular holiday. We have Sarah Paulus live at a house in Eagan that spares no expense on Halloween. Sarah, how's it looking?
All right, well, it's looking really good here. And about last year, there was about 115 million houses in the U.S. that were potential stops for trick-or-treaters. And while many people decorate for Halloween, very few houses decorate like this. I'm here at 712 Stonewood Road here in Eagan, where the Smith family has gone to great lengths to decorate their house for Halloween for over 30 years. I met with homeowner Joan Smith last year to get the lowdown on how this all started.
Yeah, we moved in here about 30 years ago and started doing it back then when my kids were little, and they love Halloween. I always loved Halloween. When we started doing it, there weren't very many houses here. Obviously, we were the first house. And then as people came in, they said how much they loved it. So we promised them we'd just keep doing it until we moved, and we're still doing it. We'd add little headstones, and we'd name people we knew and make up funny reasons they died. Now, the car is my husband, when he was young, used to drive this car. So. It really is old, and we've always had it inside, and we don't have a hearse, but we kind of turned it into a hearse, and it's just great props, so we've kept it. We probably bring in at least 3 times as much as most people do. The school buses drive by, and the kids see it, they tell their parents, and every year more and more people would drive busloads of kids in to come trick-or-treating at our house on Halloween. But when people come over, and they'll ring the doorbell even early, can we walk through? Everybody's welcome to walk through and read and enjoy, and that's why we put it up, you know, so people can do that. And I want everybody to enjoy the day. It's just a fun day, and it should be fun. And the kids, you see them coming here, they want to see it, but they're scared. And there's something about, it's fun about being scared, you know, on Halloween. And I have people that come back every year, getting older and older and older. Oh, I love it. I come here every year. They love coming here on Halloween night.
All right. Well, the yard is decked out and candy is on hand. And I know many kids have marked this house for their trick-or-treating route tonight. The Smith family is very excited to share their house with Eagan tonight. And I know they expect an awesome turnout as usual. Reporting for Eagan AM, I'm Sarah Paulus.
Thanks, Sarah.
I'm definitely going to check that place out.
I'm not.
Now over to Super Stoker with some seriously stoked up sports.
Hello, boys and girls, and welcome to the Wildcat Report. We've got a lot of sports to cover, so let's get right into it. 3 weeks ago, the football team took on Lakeville North. The defense played an outstanding game, only giving up 3 points to the Panthers in the first half. The boys fought hard against the fourth-ranked Panthers, but came up short, losing 24-0. 2 weeks ago, they headed out to Apple Valley to take on the Eagles. Highlights shone bright at the end of the game, with everybody's favorite runner, Jake Gorley, scoring his first touchdown of the season. Gorley finished with 72 rushing yards. Ian Ensign also threw for 99 yards as the guys came up short, 28-7. The team took on Lakeville South last Friday for their first game of section play. The defense played an awesome game, once again led by junior captain Joe Kovac, who racked up 13 tackles. Senior quarterback Ian Ensign led the offense with over 200 all-purpose yards, which included 148 through the air. They played well, but ended up losing with a final score of 10-0. Great season, boys. It was a blast. Girls Swim and Dive matched up against Bloomington Kennedy 2 weeks ago and beached the Eagles with a final score of 74-35. Last Tuesday, the girls took on powerhouse Rosemont Irish and came close to the 7th-ranked team in state, losing 98-83. Good luck at sections next week, girls. The boys' soccer team finished the regular season strong. They went off to Burnsville High School to take on the Eastview Lightning in the section championship. Our Wildcats ultimately came up short, losing 3-2. The boys had an awesome season, finishing 13-2-3. Congratulations to senior captain Ryan Mott for being named to the All-State Honorable Mention team. Ryan was also named to the Academic All-Conference team alongside senior captain Ed Olson. Congratulations to all the guys on an awesome season. The girls' soccer team also had an outstanding finish to their regular season. The ladies went off to Eastview to take on the Lightning in the conference semis. They took a quick lead, but in the end came up short with a score of 4-1. The girls finished the season 11-3-2. Congratulations to senior Kelly Wickard, who was named to the All-State Honorable Mention team alongside sophomore goal-scoring phenom Taylor Keneally. Compliments to those two and all the Lady Cats on a fantastic season. The cross-country teams both finished up their regular season strong. The boys had some great runs at the South Suburban Conference Championship meet, which took place here at Eagan. Highlights came from senior captains Dan Potpester, who finished 20th, and Josh Potpester, who finished 25th, just 10 seconds behind his brother. They then ran at the section meet and placed 6th as a team. Josh Potpester was the leading man for the Cats this time around, placing 17th overall, and coming up just short from advancing to the state meet for the second year in a row. The girls also had an outstanding conference meet, finishing 2nd as a team, with a great performance from junior Anna Van Wick, who finished 2nd overall. They went to the section meet last Thursday and took 1st place. Anna Van Wick won the race outright, with Raisa Hansen placing 7th and Kelly Praska, who came in 14th. The next step for the team is the state meet this Saturday at St. Olaf. Congratulations, girls, and good luck Saturday. The volleyball team continues to dominate the floor. They took on Kennedy last Thursday and won handily 3-0. That advanced them to the section semifinals, which took place Thursday night here at Eagan against the Rosemont Irish. They dominated without losing a game. Nice work, ladies. They look to keep this momentum going as they take on Alyssa Gaynor and the Lakeville North Panthers this Saturday at 7 o'clock in Prior Lake. Keep up the good work, girls, and make Eagan proud. Well, as always, it's great to be a Wildcat. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Josh.
Eagan S Talent has a rehearsal from 5 to 9 tomorrow night in the auditorium.
And finally, the Senior Party Planning Group will meet next Monday, November 4th, in Lecture Room B at 7 o'clock.
That's all we got for you on this moderately spooky day.
Stay classy, San Diego. Stay classy, Eagan.
To the master bedroom where the vampires feast, the ghouls all came from their humble abodes to get a jolt from my electrodes. They did the monster mash. It was a graveyard smash. It caught on in a flash. They did the monster mash. The zombies were having fun. The party had just begun. The guests included Wolfman.